Hi everyone, welcome to my channel Cyber Preserve. Today we are going to have a cyber career talk, and for that I have three guests today with me. So let's not further delay and start the talk. Let me introduce you to my very special guest today, who is a cybersecurity expert, master instructor, owner of KNL Tech, and many other feathers in his hat. Please welcome the very talented Ken Underhill. Hi, Ken. Thank you for coming to my channel today.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's definitely a pleasure to be here.
Please tell us more about yourself, because I have known you have been an influencer to students across the globe. So please tell us more about yourself and your background.
Sure. I mean, I kind of had the traditional route, right? I worked as a sysadmin, network engineer, kind of moved into security. And then I worked at a healthcare company that was a little cheap. And so they kind of made me the jack of all trades. So I did pen testing. I did defensive side, a lot of work with SIM tools like Splunk. And then from there, I started teaching online, got involved with Cybery. They happened to have an opening right around the same time I started teaching for them. And so it just kind of worked out. So I've been with Cybery. I also, as you mentioned, I own a tech company. So I kind of a mixture there. We do revenue generation using technology online for people. And then also we have a cyber component where we just give mostly advisement to smaller businesses on what should they be doing. And of course, with everything you see in the media that scares people, we kind of break it down like, what do you really need to actually worry about? So that's kind of what I'm mostly focused on right now.
Wonderful. That's really wonderful and good to know from you. And so let's introduce our two more guests today, who are not experts from cybersecurity, but are the budding cybersecurity professionals and future in the area of cybersecurity. So I would like to welcome Saman Fatima, who is from India, New Delhi, and Sahil, who is currently in New York, United States. So Saman and Sahil, please introduce yourself. Saman, you start first, followed by Sahil. Saman, you're mute.
Okay. Sorry. Hi, Astha, and hello, everyone. Hi, Ken. Hi, Sahil. And it's me, Saman Fatima. Right now, I am working as a cybersecurity person currently in the IAM domain as a SailPoint developer with Macquarie Bank here in New Delhi. And I have been into this field for like 3 years. Like, I started up with this field itself, and I started with the IAM domain. And I am really, really interested to, you know, learn more and more in depth about this field, you know, to more nurture myself and to be more, you know, connected to this field, because it feels really interesting, you know, what all day to day we feel about this field. So yeah, that's all about.
Thank you, Saman. Sahil?
Yeah, I'm sure. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Hi everyone. Hi Ken. Hi Asta. Hi Saman. Firstly, Asta, thank you for having me here. It's really a great opportunity to talk to Ken. About myself, I started off in cybersecurity 3 years ago in TCS as like Asta and Saman, and I worked there for 1 year. After that, I chose to come to for masters in cybersecurity, and have been taken many courses in cybersecurity courses in 2 years, and been doing projects, research projects in 2 years, and also been working with Professor Thomas Farrington as a graduate assistant, working on a cloud platform and handling security for it. So that's also been I've been working on for 1 year. I have knowledge of basically in every domain of security, because I've taken security courses in NYU. So initially in the first year, I was more focused into the binary exploitation and more in penetration testing. But in third semester, I was more focused on security analysis part. And right now I'm doing much more bug bounty hunting and penetration testing web application security. So I'm kind of in the gray area between the proactive and reactive securities, but I'm still trying to explore more and what do I like about the security. But if I say I want to pursue my next 5 years in more in proactive security, like in penetration testing or security analysis, security assessment. Yeah.
Thank you, Sahil. So before going forward to discuss what struggles Sahil and Saman are having currently in their career and what struggle they face, for example, what I know from Saman is that she has switched her job from like one company to another company, and Sahil moved on to doing masters in cybersecurity. So before discussing their struggles today, Akin, I have some questions for you. Like, in the past few weeks, I have many students and professionals who reached out to me on LinkedIn stating that they are part of our connections. They see our videos, they see your posts, and many other cybersecurity experts. But the only question they have in mind currently is where to start. And they always ask me, like, can you please have some time to discuss with me where to start? And all these professionals are from across the globe. Most of them are from India and the other part is from United States and few of them are from Europe. So my question to you is, you have taught a lot of students across globe. You have actually helped, I think, to 600 to 800 professionals in clearing their certifications. So what type of advice you have for freshers and for professionals who want to switch their domain? I think that's the current struggle, because right now I am having two kinds of requests. One is how to start, and second is I'm bored of my domain in security right now. I have knowledge about other area, but how should I switch? How would companies actually accept me, like in interviews, or they will actually find me capable for those kinds of job? So what's your take in that?
So as far as kind of determining like which way you should go, both as a fresher or professional that's already in the industry, I think you just have to expose yourself through free training and see, okay, I like working with this thing, or I like this topic, it interests me. Because if you're not passionate about it, a lot of people, especially freshers here in the US, look for what am I going to make the most money in, right? And it's all about the money. And they go do something they absolutely hate. Yes, they make six figures eventually, but they really hate it. So you have to be passionate, because if you're not going to be passionate about a certain thing, then you're not going to be a good practitioner of that. It doesn't matter how many classes you go to, et cetera, because you're really just thinking always, oh, I need more money, 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 money. And you're not going to be good at that. So I say start with free resources, play around with different things. I think Autopsy, if you're interested like in forensics out there listening to this, Autopsy still has a free course, I think for a few more weeks. It's an 8-hour course. So jump on that, see if you like forensics. Pen testing, there's a lot of free resources. Philip Wiley, who I think you're connected to as well, Asta.
Yeah.
He has a lot of free stuff out there on pen testing. So if you think you want to hack stuff, you want to be a hacker, then there's good stuff like that. So really just use the free resources. I tell people don't pay for stuff, because until you know you actually like it, you shouldn't put any money down for it. Now, kind of the flip side of your question there was, okay, I'm already a professional, and you know, we'll use Saman as an example. She's doing IAM stuff right now, but let's say she's like, you know what, I've thought about changing something, pen testing stuff kind of sounds cool. Like, how do I actually position myself for an employer where they'll say, you know what, let's give you a chance? I think the way to do that, with no matter what area of cyber you're trying to do as your next thing, you have to, number one, prove you have the skills. You don't have to have all the skills, right? She doesn't have to be the world's greatest pen tester right off the bat, but she does have to understand some of the fundamentals and understand how can I, and for me, I would suggest people that are outside of the US focus on more web app pen testing, because that opens you up to remote work potentially, or remote projects at least, that you can do from where, whatever country you're in. If you're focused on network pen testing, a lot of times you have to be in person for that, or at least in that country for them to allow you to do that. So that's why I say focus on that. But really just focusing on some of the fundamental skills. Just be able to show me that you can go to a website, you can scan it for vulnerabilities on your own website. And I mean, that might be enough to get you that job, right? Or at least the interview. The way to do that, and I don't really see a lot of people doing this. So the way to do that is to film yourself. Screen recording software, you can use like OBS, it's free. Screencast-O-Matic has a free version. It'll have their logo in it someplace, but nobody cares about that. Just film it, put it up on like YouTube, say, here's how I do Nmap, and this is what I'm doing with Nmap, and this is why I'm doing this, and just teach people what you know. Everyone knows something, right? Like Saman does stuff in her daily stuff that I probably don't know. Sahil does stuff in his daily stuff that I probably don't know, right? So if he filmed videos on that, and I'm a hiring manager out there, and I see those videos, I say, you know what, yes, he doesn't have everything we're looking for in this job description, but he does have these skills and we can build off those. So let's go ahead and give him a call and set up an interview. So it's really just kind of, if you're starting out and you're trying to figure out like, do I have an interest in this? Use a free resources. And then the other answer there is expose yourself, sell yourself is really what you're doing there. You're showing that you have those skills because everybody, I get 1,000 LinkedIn messages. I've got all these skills. Show me, right? Yeah. Film a video. It doesn't have to be perfect audio or any, you literally just film a video showing you have those skills and that can open up a lot of doors for you.
Definitely. Thank you so much. Actually, I think that was the real point, which I had never in my mind, because I had professionals reaching out to me like what to do. And I used to tell them like, build your skills, join these free courses. But the only thing I think which I was missing in guiding them was like, shoot some videos somewhere or the other way, show your skills. And I guess this is something I have been doing myself, but I never thought about telling it to anybody. Because I think the other thing when I tell people to do that is that it's about trust, or it's about actually being convinced. Because sometimes when I tell students or professionals, do this, for example, you want to come to my channel, let's shoot this. So this has happened like in last week, I told someone to do this and they were like gone. So I think there is some stage fear or presentation fear as well as in them. So thank you so much for all these points. The other thing is, as you mentioned about the employers, this was my next question, because I have seen job descriptions for 2 years experience professional showcasing like they have done like a 10 years job in this area. Like you should have this certification. How can you expect a 2 year professional to have CISSP? CISSP requires so much experience to actually exhibit its implementation. So what suggestion you have for employers right now? Like this is crazy. And I think that's the reason like professional like Saman and Sahil, they actually apply for jobs, like who have 1 year experience, 2 year experience, 3 year experience. They apply for job, but they never get shortlisted. And the mail you get is, you don't match our job requirements. So I want to know who make these job requirements, these job descriptions. And the funniest part is I gave an interview for a similar company anyhow or somehow, and I got selected and I went there for like few months and I never got to do which was mentioned in the job requirement. I was just doing something else. It was bullshit, I guess, at that point of time. I would perfectly say it to employers right now, like, why do you write such requirements and expectations from the employees or from the aspirants that they should not be actually having? Just judge them on their caliber. Actually give them space. Don't give them pressure. What do you have on this? What are your thoughts?
Yeah, you touched on something a lot of us talk about in the industry, these ridiculous job postings. Hey, it's an entry-level job with minimum wage, but you need to have a CISSP and a CISM and a C-RISC and, in a CISA, and like, come on now, right? So we know that's an issue. If we just take a step back though, if we look at most jobs, and I'm gonna speak from the US because I haven't gotten jobs in India or anything like that, so it might be a little different there. But here in the US, 50 to 80% of jobs that you get are through networking. It's not sending off your resume, it's not going to recruiters, it's none of that, right? The majority of the time, if you can network effectively, that's how you find out about jobs that aren't even created yet. And I've had that happen to me. I've casually talked to people in my past when I worked in healthcare a lot, and I'd say, you know what, it'd be kind of cool to work at that company. And they're like, oh, we've actually been talking about creating a job around this. Do you have this skill? I'm like, yeah. Like, okay, you want the job? Sure. I was like, can we talk about like what it pays, you know? But it's just, networking is the biggest thing. But kind of touching on the job description for a moment, I tell people, and this is actually from recruiters as well, here in the States, as well as like in Europe. Usually the first 2 to 3 bullet points on a job description are kind of the must-haves. Now, if you see an entry-level job with CISSP as one of the first couple bullet points, that it kind of shows you that company is naive in security, and they're probably not a good match for you, because it's probably just going to be a big pain to work at that place. So look at the first couple of job bullets see, do I have those skills or do I have something that's kind of comparable or is that something I can learn or grow into? And then I would shoot off the resume. But again, the biggest thing to do is networking and building and don't just get a bunch of like LinkedIn connections, right? A lot of people make that mistake. Actually build real relationships and identify, like if you say you want to work at Google, number one, it's going to be tough, those big, you know, the big companies to get a job at. But let's just say you want to work at Google and let's pretend it was easy to get a job there. So what you want to do is find people that work at Google and don't just message them saying, give me a job. Like that's, you're going to get blocked. But if you say, hey, do you have any recommendations? Like when you went through the interview process, any tips or anything that you might've been asked as part of your role that might be something that I should learn or something that you're doing right now without telling me all the technology you use, is there a certain technology that I should be learning? And most of the time when you approach people like that, they want to help, right? Most people are inclined to help each other. If you approach them like that, then they'll say, yeah, here's kind of a list or here's some free resources to get into that space. So an example of that is someone reached out to me, this is right after Black Hat, so this is almost a year ago, but they wanted to get into critical infrastructure, so ICS, SCADA stuff. Not my space at all, I'll be honest, that's not my stuff at all, but I have a huge network that is in that space and really, really good friends. So when that person reached out and said, how do I learn this stuff? I just reached out to my network for them. And I said, hey, and they shot a bunch of free resources over. They said, let them, you know, have them go through this and then connect them with us and we can mentor them as they're going through. Now that person's working in the space, you know, kind of in their dream job. So it's really just about reaching out, letting people know you need the help. And then going back to what I said earlier on the videos, you have to put in some work, right? So even if you don't want to be on camera on a video, that's fine. Just record your screen and walk me through stuff. Cause I don't need to see you if you're showing me like Nmap or cracking a password with John the Ripper or something. I don't need to see you on camera. Just show me what you're doing. So all that is kind of puzzle pieces, right? If we think of it like a puzzle, you have to put yourself out there a little bit, get uncomfortable, because that's the way to a success. You have to be uncomfortable. And then the other part of that is meeting the right people and building real relationships with them. And that's going to position you the best for any job across the board. Because I know some people from India that successfully got a job from companies in the US and they paid for them to come over and all that stuff. So it's not impossible. I know we talked, I think when you came on the podcast, Asta, about jobs in India and how it's very difficult a lot of times. But if you put yourself out there, if you build relationships, you position yourself better than the majority of people out there. And so you should have not a whole lot of trouble getting that job.
I think like we talked about job requirements, definitely sometimes they are bizarre because you don't connect to them. So that's fine at one end. That is acceptable. We can actually reach out. And I think companies now know, because there have been so many posts on LinkedIn by HRs only or some of the recruiters or some of the professionals, like, don't put these kind of job posts. At least you're asking for 1 year experience and don't put all these information, because 1 year's experience is very less. So keeping that aside, the other thing is what should be the professionals be doing for like growing in this career? I think the very important thing you mentioned is to be active, to showcase your skills in any way possible. But the next thing is, what should they do? The question is, would they be doing any kind of masters? Is masters mandatory, or is certification is another option which is good and help them in long term? Like, for example, going back to Saman and Sahil, I would like now to discuss their struggles. Like, Saman has not done any masters in cybersecurity, and Sahil is currently just graduating this year in cybersecurity. So I think Saman and Sahil, you should start discussing your struggles with Ken now.
Should I go first?
Yeah.
Okay. So, Ken, as you talked about right now about the networking, right? So, my question or my counter argument was that, so I've been here for 2 years, and in the first year I tried to do the networking through career fairs and through going to the conferences, to going out after going into the keynote speaking areas, or some conferences like InfoSecurity, but I couldn't get into the Black Hat in DEF CON, obviously, because you have to clear the CDS for that. So that's the conferences I couldn't get in. But I have tried to network as much as possible. But on the career fair side, I would say, I just feel that it's my personal feeling that career fairs are like I'm not satisfied, or like it's career fairs are the biggest scam in the colleges right now, because most of the career fairs employers are just there to promote themselves. I feel that, because most of the big companies, they tell you to apply online. So I am already on the same base as other students. So there was no benefit me going there. And in the career fair, there are thousands of students as like me. So if everyone is putting their resume and on their desk, I think that also goes into the trash after that, because I have put many resumes on the desk, and I have approached many HRs in the career fair, but it's very difficult to get a reply back from them after the career fair. So I think networking is it's difficult if you are a student, because I have to make a decision, either I have to spend my time on studying things or go out and spending 3 to 4 hours in a keynote session or in some speaking. Obviously it helps, it definitely helps students to get in front of other students in competition, but would you prefer a student with less skill but more networking, or with more skills but less networking? Like, that's my, yeah. So if you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, so more skills, but so I think when I say networking, it's not so much of let me go to every conference, you know, or all these conferences. It's not let me speak at keynotes, you know, unless you can get the recording of those and kind of put them in your own YouTube channel or something. I wouldn't necessarily, when you're a student still, I wouldn't necessarily do all that. It's fine to do a couple, but you want a recording of that you can leverage. Yeah. I would say more so the networking, especially in your situation where you've got to study and, you know, you're very busy. It's tough to go out in person, so leverage it online. And it doesn't have to be going to conferences online. It could be more of leveraging like the power of LinkedIn or something, right? And then kind of asking people through LinkedIn, do you have projects I can help out on? Also going to, you guys have heard of Udemy.com. Going to Udemy.com, finding some of the top instructors there, find them on LinkedIn. Right. Send them a message, can I help you? Can I maybe help manage student stuff on your course or something, right, to help them out? Because then you get a reference from somebody that's already in the industry, and you say, and plus they'll pay you usually. Charge them money, don't let them get you for free. But you know, things like that, right? That's the real networking. That's the networking before we all got into going to conferences and all this stuff. Like that's the fundamental networking stuff, and that's the stuff that I'm talking about.
Oh, okay.
So you don't have to go in person, right? A lot of people are too, like I go to, well, now with COVID-19, I don't go to anything, but with, you know, conferences, I normally only go to like a couple a year, right?
Okay.
Because it's just, they're so time consuming and travel and all that stuff, right? And I'm just too busy. So for me, the biggest networking I've done, at least in this particular industry, is via like LinkedIn, right?
Okay.
And online things. So for you as a student, leverage the power of online. Yeah. And you also have to be strategic about it, right? Like, don't just network with like everybody possible. Pick kind of the influencers, right? Connect with them, let them open up their networks, because for like Asta to say like, hey, Sahil is really, really good. I heard you needed help on this and he's really good at that. Let me connect you to, that's a big difference versus you going to a keynote, coming up as kind of a fanboy, as we call it in the US, coming up as a fanboy to the person speaking like, oh, you did such a great job, right? They just kind of ignore you, right? Yeah. But if someone else that they know says, hey, this person's good, then that carries a lot more weight. So when I say networking, don't worry about you have to go to X number of conferences or speaking events, et cetera, because you, from your experience, you're finding that that's not the way to do it. So pivot, do it online. You mentioned you do bug bounties. Keep doing more of those. I would also try to find smaller pen testing companies that might give you a chance to work as like a junior pen tester or something.
Okay.
And I don't know about your degree or if you've got a scholarship that prevents you from working or whatever, but at a minimum, you could do volunteer work a couple part-time for them to get the experience,
yep,
to put on your resume, and they may end up hiring you, right, remotely or something. So you just kind of have to, like, when you're in a situation where this is kind of a life thing, right? When you're in a, yep, situation where like you're doing the same thing and it's not working, usually just pivot and then something will work. So for you, Sahil, I would say, and anyone out there listening that's having the same struggle, pivot online, focus more on the online, get your LinkedIn. Are we connected on LinkedIn? I'm not sure.
I think so. I've seen many posts. If I'm on LinkedIn, I'm a cybersecurity specialist. I cannot avoid your name on the LinkedIn. That's the period.
Okay, cool. But I say, just connect with people. You're in the pen testing space, which I have a huge network in.
Yeah.
As things are happening, as you learn more skills, that's why I kind of go back to always film yourself doing things, because I have a lot of things in process right now. And I know some people that have a lot of things in process after COVID-19 kind of blows over. So the people that are showcasing their skills that we feel are kind of in the right spot, right? That kind of opens up those doors, right? So I'm just going to say it like that, not making any type of thing, but offer anything. But I'm just saying that there's, when you put yourself out there, people always have things going on. They're always looking to hire people. They're always looking to plug you into something, right? Maybe a new company they're forming or whatever. So if you can showcase yourself, and that's the power of the internet, right? That's really what the intent is. So for you, I wouldn't recommend going to any more conferences unless you have to. Yeah. I would put it all online. Like I'm gonna start a YouTube channel this weekend, and I'm gonna start filming myself doing these different pen testing things, right? And then I'm gonna share that YouTube channel. So this is a homework assignment for you. Create a YouTube channel if you don't have one, right? It doesn't matter what the name is, whatever. And then film some videos of yourself doing these different things, right? Just a couple things. So film a couple videos this weekend with a free Screencast-O-Matic is probably the best one to just start filming with, right? Is you can do it for free and nobody cares that it's got a logo in there. And then what you do, share that YouTube channel link with me, and that way I can do a post next week on it and say, hey, check these videos out. So homework assignment, get that done, share that link with me via LinkedIn, and then we'll start pushing that out there for you. But put yourself out there, man. That's kind of the biggest takeaway. Put yourself out there, stop doing the stuff that's not working. Because as you mentioned, thousands of students are doing that, right? So if they're all doing it, you have to stand out from the crowd. Yes. And because that's nice, you know, you want to help other people, you want them to get jobs too, but really you need the job first, right? You need the job, you need the money first to help other people. So, sure. So that's kind of my recommendation there. Like change what you're doing, focus more on the online and proving yourself skill-wise. And that's it may not happen right away, but if you start doing that now and you're consistent, maybe 2 months down the line, you get some job offer from like Google, right? And they're like, yeah, we want you to finish your master's here in the States. And by the way, we're going to pay for it. And you're going to make more than, you know, Ken and Asta combined and, you know, whatever. Yeah. So that's my recommendation. Focus more on the online, because that's going to help you a lot more than what you're doing.
That's really helpful advice. I've always tried to build a public profile, either it's GitHub or Medium, blogs, or Bug Bounty profile. But I've never thought about the point of view from putting up a video, but that's really good. I'll definitely try that.
Yeah, and in those videos, link to all your other stuff, right? Yeah. You want to check out my portfolio on GitHub, it's right here. You want to, you know, my contact information is at this link. If you want to, if you've got a job or you know of a job that's really good, or you want to talk to me further, here you go. So yeah, you're just, really it's just sales, right? That's all it is. If you want to be successful at any job, it doesn't matter, cybersecurity, whatever, you just have to sell yourself properly, right? And most practitioners have no sales skills. So that's why they kind of struggle to get that first job and stuff like that. But if you focus on selling yourself, then you kind of put yourself out there and you almost position yourself right off the bat as an expert, because people see, okay, well, he knows Nmap really well, or he knows web app pen testing really, really well. He can run Burp Suite with the best of them, right? And you prove that. And so now people that are thinking about creating a job for people remember your name because they watch your YouTube videos. Right. So they reach out to you and they automatically know that you're not going to be cheap. Right. They're not going to be able to give you some low salary. They know that they're going to have to pay for you because you've got a following and stuff. So that's my recommendation for you. I think that's probably going to help you quite a bit.
Okay. Yeah, that's really helpful. Definitely. I'll do that.
Yeah. Don't forget homework assignment. You know, make sure you share that link.
You'll be getting the work in by next week of sharing my post. Definitely.
Okay. Perfect.
Thank you so much, Ken. Thank you so much. What's your points and struggles?
Yeah. So talking about my career shift, I started up 3 years back with TCS. So I have learned like that was my fresher company, and I've started with them and started with the cybersecurity field. So it has kind of developed an interest for me, especially with the topics and, you know, with a lot of things going around. Partially, I am not much as a part of cybersecurity. It's like IAM is a very small domain to be counted under cybersecurity. But talking of interest, the major problem, the major shift which I am facing is like if you wanted to shift from one of the domains in cybersecurity, like currently I am in IAM domain and I want to shift up to some other, you know, either tool knowledge or, you know, or something like this pen testing or something into authorization and authentication, anything. It's that shift that is having a problem right now. Like, where should we shift to? Like, what grounds should I consider to shift to a different topic or to a different sphere, but just remaining into the same field? So Ken would be needing help on that.
Sure. I think the first place to start is with your current company. Do they offer, you know, have you asked your boss, like, hey, I'm kind of interested in this other thing. Do we have a way for me to learn that and also make it part of my current job? Usually that's the best place to start, is where you're currently working. Now, they might not have that as an option, right? I mean, you might not be able to move to a different job or learn that new thing where you're at. So from there, I would just try to find, it's, again, goes back to the passion. Like, what are you interested in? So if you're not interested in pen testing, you know, you wouldn't pivot to that. But maybe around IAM, maybe if you don't know like Python or something, you could learn Python and then learn to write some scripts that help with IAM, right? So that way, even though you're not able to pivot right now in your company, you're building another skill set that either in another company or in your current company can be used sort of in the future, right? So think more of initially start off like go ask your boss, like, hey, I'm interested in switching to more of an analyst type of role, right? And do we have that in this company? Or is there a way for me to kind of do some of those tasks that an analyst would do in my current job? And just see what they say. They may say, no, why are you asking me, whatever, you know, and that's fine. Some companies will do that. But if they're willing to do that, then that's the place I would start at. But then otherwise I would think of, you know, for example, like I just talked about analysts. So someone doing a very sub niche of IAM, that's a skill set in that an analyst would have to have, right? So when you're looking to pivot into, okay, I want a more quote unquote kind of dedicated cybersecurity role that will expose me to a lot more things, you might look at training for being a SOC analyst or, you know, cybersecurity analyst or whatever, and building that skill set off if you don't have it already, because right now you're doing the IAM, but maybe you can build out and learn, just, you know, use a free training from Splunk, right? Or use any number of SIEM tools out there, use Qualys stuff and just get that exposure, use Alien Vault, you know, and just kind of building your skill sets that way with the ultimate goal of, I want to get an analyst job, whether that's at my current company or whether this new skill set will give me a better job or give me an opportunity internationally if that's what I want. But that's kind of how it's kind of two answers there, right? It's answer number one is start with your current company, just see what you can do with them and what they're willing to either pay for training on or that you can tack on to your job to get some more hands-on. And let me ask you this, with what you're doing, is there a dedicated cyber team there? Do they have people that are doing pen testing? Do they have people that are analysts? Do they have people in risk management? Do they have all that stuff right now? Okay.
Yeah, because we have a broader team, which includes like smaller divisions, which handles like, you know, one is part of the identity and access management, other deals with the, you know, privilege access management, the PAM people. And, you know, subsequently we have cyber teams for the vulnerability scan people or, you know, broader team versions. We have everything, but it's just for the interest. Like it's dependent on us as well, like which company we want to hop on to. That's also a confusion, like what we like is, you know, we do not know yet.
Yeah, and that kind of that goes back to what I said earlier on, right? Of just using free resources to figure out what that is, right? And just kind of see. So maybe, you know, you might find that you love vulnerability scanning. So I think that you just need to download something like the free version of Nessus or OpenVAS or something, and run some scans in a lab, and just see like, okay, this is kind of fun finding the vulnerabilities, and then research a little bit about them and figure out how you would kind of talk to your manager about those if they didn't know anything about it, and you say, hey, I found these vulnerabilities and this is what this means, and this is why we should be concerned. And then if you find you like that stuff, then that's where I go to your current company, because you have all that there. It sounds like you just have to kind of determine what you like. Then I would say, hey, I've been playing around with these different vulnerability scanners. It seems kind of interesting. Can I get some cross training with that other team on there? Can I sit with them for a day or a half day or my next day off? Can I come in and can I just sit with them and learn from them? And then you start getting that cross training. So you're in a position, it sounds like, where you're kind of fortunate where the company has all these different things you can get involved in. For me, when you're speaking to someone, it just seems like you're more of, I got to figure out what I want to do of these areas. And kind of the only way to do that is to like do them. So you may not download stuff yourself and play around. What you might just do is ask your employer if, like, on your days off or for like just 1 hour a day, if you can go sit with that team, see what they're doing, get some exposure to that, and just see if it's kind of better to do it if you can get it like in person, on, you know, and seeing like a real company doing it and real practitioners doing it versus an online course. So that would be my recommendation. Just kind of ask like, hey, can I take an hour, even if it's my lunch break, can I take my lunch break and go sit with that team and just be exposed to that and see if that's something, you know, I've kind of had an interest in that. I'm not sure if I like it or not. Do you mind if I do that? And I don't know how India is, but at least in the US, if you ask that question, most employers are going to say that's fine, right? Because there's no harm. You're already in the team. You're already cleared for whatever they want you to see usually. And you can go look at that stuff. So that's where I would start out with your current employer and just ask them. So your homework assignment is your next day at work, just ask your boss, hey, I've kind of been interested in these other things the cyber team is doing. Do you mind if I take like my lunch break or I take a, you know, 30 minutes or an hour once a week and just go sit with one of those teams? And if yes, can you set that up for me? Can you call those managers and just see if it's okay for me to do that?
Yeah. I guess that would be really helpful. So yeah, I'll be bugging my boss now.
bug your boss. That's, if you get one takeaway for the audience listening to this, bug your boss. ask them for the, you know, because a lot of people don't ask, right? They sit there, they're frustrated and stuff. Just ask, you know, the worst case scenario is you're told no. And then you know, okay, well, I need to set up my own virtual machines and practice on my own.
So finishing up with my first question, I have the second question. I have done only my bachelor's in technology, and then I started up with my career in TCS and now in Macquarie. So what would you suggest if for further growth, what would be best, you know, considered for people like me around, that would we be going for some certifications into cybersecurity or rather pursuing the master's as Sahil is doing that? So what would be the best scenario which would actually upskill us into this field?
Sure. So with that question, when I get it, number one, you don't need any degree or certifications. There's a lot of people in the industry that have worked for 20 plus years. But the question I always ask, and the only reason I did my master's degree, I'll just throw that on the table, was because it was free, because I had money left over from the military. So basically my education was free. So I didn't have to pay for anything. So that's the only reason I did it. Now other people do it because it's like a bucket list item or they think that's going to position themselves better. For your situation, Saman, I would probably, especially if you're going to have to pay out of pocket, I would probably focus on getting some certifications. So if you don't have like Security Plus, I'd probably pick that one up, because if you want to get a job as an analyst, that's usually the cert they're looking for in your first job or whatever. So I think that would be a beneficial for one for you. And I don't know the pricing on that. It might be cheaper to do other vendor certifications in India, but you just kind of have to figure out what your pricing is, but that's what I would do. Now, if you don't have the finances to pay for a certification right now either, what I would suggest is just finding like a low cost or free course on it. Like Professor Messer on YouTube has a lot of like Network Plus, Security Plus training, usually training videos that are all free. So just learn the stuff, right? You don't have to pay for the cert. You can just say that I'm studying for, and you can even put that in your resume, I'm studying for Security Plus. Right. And so that's a conversation starter when you go in for like an interview. Not, by the way, if her employer's listening, she's not interviewing, don't worry. But it, you know, if you are going for like an interview or something, you could say, I'm studying for Security Plus. And when the hiring manager asks you, okay, well, what things are you learning so far? Oh, well, I've learned about cryptography, and you kind of explain some things on that, right? So going back to the answer to your question, there's really not an answer for it. It's really, the answer for it is who's paying for it. That's my answer for it. If you have to pay for the master's yourself, and if you're going to have to take out like student loan debt to do it, again, I don't know India. I don't know if you get student loans or whatever, but if you have to take out like debt to do it, I wouldn't do it. Same with the certification. If you have to take out debt to do it, I wouldn't do it. I would just learn the stuff, practice it hands-on, because that's what's going to matter, right? A lot of people get certifications, but they can't. You have them in an interview. You tell them to do something, right? To do some IAM or you know, some privileged access management or something, or to run a scan and NMAP, and they can't actually do it. They could talk all day about the theory, but they can't actually do it. So the biggest thing is building the skills, right? And so if you feel you can get that in a master's program or a doctorate program and you're not paying for it, you know, that's fine. But if you've got to pay for that, I wouldn't do it yet. You're still kind of early on in your career. Like Sahil, this doesn't mean you should drop out of school, by the way. Yeah, stay with what you're doing, you know, because there's nothing wrong with getting a master's, right? It does open up doors for you, but you have to think about finances. And that's something I preach a lot to the people in the industry, like get your finances in order. Because if you're taking on a lot of debt to get this degree, but that college can't prove that you're going to get a better job and they don't have that job waiting for you, I wouldn't do it. Same thing with a certification as well, right? If you feel that right now you can't financially afford it, you'd have to take out a loan to pay for the training or pay for the certification exam itself, I wouldn't do it. I would just focus on learning the skills, and then going back to what I said earlier about film and videos, show yourself doing those skills and say, I'm studying for Security Plus right now, or I'm studying for CEH or OSCP or whatever, and here's me filming videos on my journey, and here's the skills I'm learning as I go. So now when I'm a hiring manager and I bring you in for an interview and I see, well, you're studying for Security Plus, you don't have it, but tell me more about that. I noticed you on YouTube. I noticed a few videos of yours on YouTube. Seems like you know your stuff. When are you planning to take the exam? And you say, well, you know, I'm saving up to take the exam right now. As an employer, I immediately think in my head, at least good ones think in their head, okay, as part of my offer I'm going to make to this lady when I'm ready to make the offer is I'm going to say, we're going to go ahead and pay for your voucher to get that exam because we need you to get that certification. So once you get hired, we're going to give you 90 days and in 90 days you have to pass that cert and we'll pay for it. So going back to your question, you know, I know I went off on a tangent there, but going back to your question, it depends on who's paying for it, and don't go into debt to get either of those, right? Unless you can prove that there's a financial benefit from it, like an actual financial benefit. Like for example, your employer tells you if you get Security Plus and you pay for that and you get that certification, then we're going to promote you, and they make them put it in writing that, hey, we're going to promote you to this next job that's X amount of above salary than you're making now. Otherwise, don't take on debt to do any of that stuff. Just learn the skills and practice the skills.
Okay. Yeah.
So again, Sahil, don't drop out of school tomorrow. Just stay in your program.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Ken. This was like really valuable advice, like for both Saman and Sahil and those kind of professionals who are living the life similar to Saman and Sahil. And I think these are the two kinds, like one where nobody has a degree or a certification and where one has something and still they are struggling. So I would say thank you so much for your time today and sharing your valuable points, tips, and expert advice. I think this video will definitely help people around. Thank you so much for coming today. And yeah, I think this brings us to the end of this session today. So I would thank you all for coming and joining today. Thank you, Ken.
All right, thanks, guys.
Thank you so much, Ken. Thank you. Thank you,
Ken. Thank you.